At the end of this module, you will be able to identify the effects of culture on the beliefs and behaviors about dementia within the Japanese American population, to utilize appropriate assessment tools to screen for dementia in the Japanese American population, and to use culturally appropriate strategies to work effectively with the family in caring for Japanese American patients and their families.
Based on the data in the 2004 census, there are currently about 790,000 Japanese Americans in the U.S. overall. Approximately 240,500 individuals are over the age of 55, and two-thirds are American-born. One distinguishing feature is their within-group diversity. In spite of stereotypical images of Japanese Americans as a model minority, that model minority image was that they are clean, well-behaved, educated, don't complain or cause any trouble, and pay their bills on time. However, differences are seen in socioeconomic status. For example, some have achieved marked financial success, while others may live in poverty, particularly older Japanese American women. These differences depend on gender, age, generation, living arrangements, and other factors. One other factor is religion. Japanese Americans practice many different religions, like mainstream populations. Another factor is geographic differences. For example, Japanese Americans in Hawaii tend to be more aggressive and assertive because they did not face the same degree of racial and ethnic discrimination as their mainland counterparts. There are also urban and rural differences. So again, Japanese Americans are a very diverse population. Older Japanese Americans comprise one of the smallest groups of elders among Asian Pacific Islander American populations due to their length of time in this country and decreasing numbers of recent immigrants. As mentioned previously, they have been in the United States for a long time. The first immigrants arrived in the 1860s as laborers working on the Hawaiian plantations, or as railroad workers, miners, or farm laborers on the mainland farms. In 1882, because of the Chinese Exclusion Act, there was an increased demand for Japanese laborers. So from 1910 to 1920, over 70,000 workers arrived from Japan. During this same time period, there was a huge influx of women who came from Japan, first as proxy or picture brides. The number swelled from 410 married women in 1900 to over 22,000 women in 1920. And thus, the growth of Japanese American family units had begun. Another unique historical feature was the establishment of Japan towns, or nihonmachis. These distinct community centers were developed to meet the needs of early immigrant laborers and their families. Nihonmachis were cultural, social, and religious centers. And while there were large numbers of Japan towns in the early 1900s, only three remain in the United States today. They're located in San Francisco, Los Angeles, and San Jose, California. Currently, most Japanese Americans live on the United States West Coast and Hawaii. The early Japanese immigrants had unique generational identities. This concept was so important that distinct names were given for each generation in the United States. Issei were the first generation immigrants from Japan, pioneers who are now almost gone, and those who are left are frequently age 100 and older. Nisei are the second generation children of the Issei and today's elders. Kibei are Nisei who were educated in Japan when they were younger and who later returned to the United States to live. So many of them are primarily Japanese speaking. Sansei are the third generation and today's caregivers. I am a Sansei. Yonsei and Gosei are the fourth and fifth generations and the future caregivers. Other groups include a category known as war brides, or Japanese women who married U.S. servicemen. For the most part, very little is known about this cohort, but these women tended to maintain their Japanese language and traditions, and over 30,000 women are thought to be in this category. Shin Issei are the newcomers. They are businessmen and their families who are in the United States temporarily, and their numbers are also unknown because they go back and forth. Nikkei is a relatively new term coined in the 1980s, which represents all Japanese Americans of all generations. Each generation possesses unique characteristics and traits that distinguish them from one another. These photographs represent the darkest side of Japanese American history. The early Issei and their families faced many hardships. They were denied the right to become U.S. citizens. They could not purchase homes or own land, so property ownership was placed in the name of children or Caucasian friends. They could not marry outside of their race due to anti-miscegenation laws. Some attended segregated schools, especially in the Japantowns, and many college-educated Nisei could not find work except on farms, fruit stands, and menial labor, or as many women ended up as secretaries or clerks. By far the most significant event to impact current Nikkei families occurred during World War II, and this pivotal experience was something that nearly all Japanese American families have in common. Following the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, there were rumors of sabotage and fear of Japanese Americans as spies or yellow peril. In 1942, Executive Order 9066 gave 120,000 persons of Japanese descent on the West Coast only a few days to leave their homes for evacuation centers, which were really stables at racetracks. The majority of these detainees were U.S. citizens, second generation children. They were then sent to 10 relocation centers throughout the United States, which was really a euphemism for concentration camps. The reason given by the government was they were sent there for their own protection, because the U.S. was at war with Japan. Families were allowed to take only what they could carry, forcing them to sell off or abandon all property and personal possessions. And these pictures depict some of those things. Here you see the Japanese Order 9066. I'm trying to negotiate this here. Right here is the Order 9066. Here is the grandfather and his grandchildren. So you have the grandfather with children and his grandchildren with identification tags, much like baggage, waiting for a train to take them to camp. The next picture is Tule Lake, one of the 10 camps of hastily constructed barracks located in a barren desert wasteland on the California-Oregon border. And my own parents were sent to Tule Lake. You see armed guards and watchtowers that surround the camps in the next photograph. And below that, you see a family outside one of the barracks, trying to maintain a sense of normalcy for the sake of their children. The next photo shows a representative of the 442 Regimental Combat Team and the 100th Battalion. These two units were composed of volunteer soldiers from Hawaii and the U.S. camps, and ironically, they were the most highly decorated unit of the European front during World War II, and they also sustained enormously incredible casualty numbers. So discrimination and anti-Japanese sentiment was faced by evacuees during the resettlement period as well, when they were released from the camps. That's the last two pictures. The camp experience shaped many of the beliefs and the behaviors of Japanese American elders and their descendants today. Traditional Japanese families, or Japanese American families, have roots in Meiji-era Confucian teachings that were practiced in Japan during the reign of the Emperor Meiji. These include a deep respect for elders, particularly parents and grandparents. The second one is in the United States. We focus on individual and individual rights and autonomy. But traditional Japanese society held that family needs and desires are paramount. What is best for the family is not necessarily what the individual is best for the individual. And frequently you hear elders say they do not want to be a burden on their family because of this belief. So it's the family emphasis versus individual focus. Deference to authority is another value. Not questioning or not challenging authority, such as doctors or nurses or teachers, because it is thought to be disrespectful. In U.S. values, people confront others when there is a problem or a disagreement arises. But Japanese Americans were taught to avoid conflict and confrontation and to deal with sensitive problems quietly, if at all. So sometimes denial was a solution. Indirect communication is another value. In the U.S., we are encouraged to speak out and to ask for assistance. But Nikkei believe in intuitive interpersonal communication. That is, people should be able to anticipate needs and preferences without someone having to articulate them. So, for example, parents are not overtly affectionate because Japanese children know that they are loved. Or another example, adult children should know what older parents expect and need. This has important implications for end-of-life decision-making or financial planning. Privacy and confidentiality are important because negative information or bad news within the family, such as mental illness, or discussing a family matter with an outsider may cause shame or loss of face to the family. Traditional Japanese families are also patriarchal or male-dominated. Especially, there's a special respect for oldest sons. So this has decision-making implications. However, the research has shown the oldest son may have responsibility caring for parents. The wives do all the hands-on care, which is not dissimilar to our mainstream caregivers. Some specific terms, Japanese terms, also reflect the Japanese values and beliefs. Oyakoko refers to filial piety, or a sense of duty and reciprocity between children and parents. This very deep sense of respect means that it is the adult child's duty and responsibility to care for their parents, no matter what. Shikata ga nai is another word. It's a sense of fatalism, or it cannot be helped, or nothing can be done. Sometimes it is reflected in not complaining about pain, or not seeking needed services or assistance, because it is fate. Gaman is a stoicism in adverse situations, like not complaining about pain or stress or problems, because the belief that withstanding these challenges builds character. Haji is a sense of shame which reflects onto the family, such as the stigma of mental health or dementia problems, or disabilities, or just being different. And Enyo is a refusal of assistance to avoid being a bother or a burden to a family member or others.